Greek Landing Day is the Saint Photios, a Greek Orthodox national shrine's annual commemoration of the first documented Greek immigrants to the New World, coming to the new Smyrna colony in 1768, which was named in honor of the thriving Greek city in Asia Minor, where many of the colonists originated. However, it is not only a remembrance of those immigrants who sailed here on these waters, but a celebration of the spirit, endurance, and commitment that has been a hallmark of Hellenic culture from ancient times to the present. And while the new Smyrna colony was to fail, the Greek colonists who came as indentured servants were to survive and thrive, despite hardship and abuse, by establishing a community within America's oldest city, St. Augustine, Florida. Indeed, there are many parallels between those colonists seeking a new and better life in the Americas and persons throughout the world today immigrating to our nation in difficult circumstances and conditions. In the Bible, the law of Moses refers several times to the protection of the alien and foreigner in the midst of Israel, specifically because the people of Israel had lived as aliens in the foreign land of Egypt, where they lived in slavery. The actions and teachings of Jesus in the Christian New Testament continue this in his encounter with the foreigners living in the Judea and Samaria of his day, despite the prejudices and bigotry of many of his fellow Jews. One could only hope that our contemporary society here in America, the vast majority being immigrants or descending from immigrants, remembers and upholds these Judeo-Christian values. The St. Photios Greek Orthodox National Shrine was established not only to remember the brave souls of Greek immigrants from long ago, but to celebrate their efforts, which would be repeated over a century later by countless Greek immigrants coming to America, beginning in the late 19th century, pausing during World War II, and then finally slowing by the 1960s. In that time, the Hellenic American community would thrive, establishing numerous parish communities, raising families, working hard in their occupations and education, and finding success. Yet, it was not always so, and we honor the sacrifices and labors of parents, grandparents, and great-grandparents whose fate in America was neither easy nor guaranteed. The odyssey of Greeks coming to the New World began on Mediterranean soil and ended in St. Augustine sand, when Corsicans, Greeks, Italians, and Minorcans left their native countries seeking a new life. The Greeks, many coming from the Mani region as well as other regions that were brutally subjugated by the Ottomans, saw the opportunity to leave for the New World as a way to break free from the chains of their oppressors in search of a better life. Even though they left a hot climate, they had no experience in a tropical environment, and their arrival in Florida thrust them into a very different way of life, not to mention a new oppressor. Colonizing Great Britain's newly acquired land of Florida became a quest for Scottish physician Andrew Turnbull. He and a partner, Sir William Duncan, each received a grant from the government of Great Britain with a stipulation that the land be settled within 10 years. Because he was familiar with the people and region, Turnbull decided to recruit settlers from Greece. His wife was the daughter of a Greek merchant in Smyrna, Asia Minor, and Turnbull believed people of the Mediterranean area were suited to the warm Florida climate. Archibald Menzies, a respected Scotsman, also believed this and issued a pamphlet in 1763 suggesting that Greeks and Armenians would be suited for work in the southern colonies. When Turnbull arrived in Greece to enlist colonists, he found devastation. Greeks in the Mani region of the Peloponnese, fearing the reprisals of the Turks, had withdrawn to the mountains. Many of the people of the villages of Mani were persuaded to leave with Turnbull, hoping to find freedom in the New World. They joined other Greek settlers, among them Caspar Papi, from Smyrna and Anastasios Mavromatis from the island of Melos. Turnbull also stopped at Crete and Santorini, where he enlisted more adventurers, including Maria Patra from Santorini, the only Greek woman known to embark on this venture. Upon his arrival at the port of Mahon Menorca, with his Greek colonists, a ship already in port contained voyagers from Corsica with Greek surnames such as Stephanopoli, Thymaraichis, Kosifaikis, and Kostas. These were descendants of the same families Turnbull had enlisted in Mani, who had fled the region years before. Turnbull's original plan had involved 500 colonists, but the number had more than doubled when the 8 ships departed Mahon March 28, 1768. Meticulously researched records from the time also prove to us today, more than 250 years later, that these first colonists cared deeply about their spiritual life in the New World. Historical records show that a Greek Orthodox priest from Laconia made the trek across the Atlantic with the colonists. The travelers were enlisted under the English Indentured Servant Act, a contract between master and servant requiring that they work the land at the owner's expense over a prearranged time. At the end of the agreed time, each was promised a tract of land. Only 1,255 of the 1,403 original group survived the ocean voyage. Scurvy, crowded conditions, and bad weather took their toll. It was not until June 26, 1768, that the first ships arrived in St. Augustine. When the colonists finally arrived here at New Smyrna, they soon learned that provisions had not been made for the expanded group. They were unexpectedly faced with clearing swampland filled with alligators, poisonous snakes, and mosquitoes. After the strenuous voyage, the settlers were happy to be on land. It was not too long, however, before they realized they were trapped in deplorable living conditions. The colonists felt they were being treated more like slaves than contracted workers, and many considered abandoning the colony. This led to a revolt. On August 19, 1768, the disgruntled colonists staged a violent revolt at the New Smyrna colony. They seized a supply ship and broke into storehouses and looted supplies. Word quickly reached Governor Grant. The rebels were arrested and transported to St. Augustine to stand trial. Neither Turnbull nor the governor wanted to jeopardize the colony by imprisoning or executing all the offenders. Therefore, after a trial in January 1769, only 3 men were chosen as examples: Carlos Forni and Giuseppe Masiadoli, both Italians, and Elias Medici, a Greek from Corsica. Medici was offered his life in exchange for executing the other 2 rebels. He was unwilling to commit the act, begging to be put to death instead. Forni and Masiadoli persuaded him to proceed, and he reluctantly hanged his 2 fellow colonists. The revolt did not bring about improvement, and the settlers continued to die in deplorable conditions. By the end of the first year, 450 men, women, and children were reported dead. Conditions continued to worsen as Turnbull and partners strove to make the plantation a successful business venture. Money was available only for improvements to projects of economic interest, not the living conditions of the colonists. The settlers continued to work and struggle, believing that someday they would receive freedom and property. For a time in the early 1770s, the plantation produced crops. Some profits were realized in 1771 and 1773. But even when the settlement improved economically, living conditions deteriorated. During the final years of this brief settlement, the British were involved in other struggles. Lieutenant Governor John Moultrie replaced Governor Grant, Turnbull's friend. Disputes between Moultrie and Turnbull made the situations more difficult and complicated the possibilities of aiding the colonists. In 1774, Patrick Tannen, the new governor, arrived. He was well aware of the colonists' problems. Unfortunately, he was unable to assist them because many political and government financial difficulties seemed to take precedent. The importance of the settlement was rapidly diminishing. By this time, the colonists had worked more years than they had contracted. They had not received the promised land nor freedom. They realized they must escape in order to survive. Legend records that visitors to Turnbull's plantation house remarked that the colonists legally could not be forced to remain in such servitude. Overhearing this, the colonists held meetings to decide what to do. In March 1777, three men secretly left the colony. They walked and swam 75 miles to St. Augustine to explain their plight to Governor Patrick Tannen. Tannen was sympathetic. He asked for written statements attesting to the atrocities, and the colonists agreed to supply the documentation of their years of turmoil. In mid-April, a group of about 90 men, women, and children, led by a Minorcan, Francisco Pelliser, marched to St. Augustine. Tannen agreed to hear their depositions against those accused of injustices. During May and June 1777, approximately 600 colonists made the treacherous journey to St. Augustine. Although many dreams had been shattered, the survivors of the New Smyrna Odyssey eagerly met the challenge of starting a new life in St. Augustine. There they were permitted to settle at the north end of St. George Street and again permitted to stay when the Spanish took back the city from the British a short time later. They were still there when Florida became part of the United States in 1822, shortly after Greek independence from the Ottoman Empire was proclaimed in 1821. One of the establishments of the Greek community in St. Augustine still stands, the oldest wooden schoolhouse, so named because it is, in fact, the oldest such structure still existent in the United States. The property was acquired by a Greek immigrant from Mani, known then as Juan Giannopoli, Ioannis Iannopoulos, who built a home in the first years of the 1800s with the first floor room serving as a classroom for Greek students of the city. In January 2020, here at the oldest wooden schoolhouse, a ceremony honoring Giannopoulos was held, culminating in the unveiling of a bust of this pioneer. The effort was undertaken by Mrs. Stella Kokolis, President of the Federation of Hellenic American Educators and Cultural Associations of America.
Juan Giannopoulos, Gian Giannopoulos. He came from Greece with the other group of Minorcans around 1760, 68. We cannot know the exact time that they arrived here, but he came from the Holy Land of Arcadia, Greece, for a better life. He struggled, but he was a man of vision, a man of values. The first thing he did was to build a house for his family that he created later, and in a very short period of time, he built the second floor as a carpenter that he was, and the first floor was dedicated to teach, to be a school to teach the Minorcans, the children, the language of the land. Juan Giannopoulos derived from Greece with the values and with the vision to be a better person. When I visited the school and I saw in the yard that Juan Giannopoulos, the builder of this school that it's survived through the years, and it's a monument for America, did not have anything to indicate who built the school. We decided, as the Federation, and with the Arcadian Federation, and the Hieros του Moria and other teachers' organizations, to build a monument, to fix the statue that stands there to remind everyone who he was, what he did, the values he carried on for this greatest country on earth, which is America.
The oldest wooden schoolhouse and St. Photius National Shrine stand as witnesses to the enduring strength of the Hellenic spirit and the achievement of Greek culture despite the vicissitudes of history. Rooted in education and their Greek Orthodox Christian faith, the Hellenes persevered through centuries of slavery and hardship under the Ottoman Empire and gained independence even before this. The colonialists at New Smyrna underwent the same but more intense experience and survived as an example for us all. And so we celebrate Greek Landing Day here in the historic city of St. Augustine, the oldest continuously inhabited city in the United States, thankful to these brave immigrants in search of a better life that helped build the soul of this great nation. At the St. Photius National Shrine, it is our endeavor and ministry to not only keep this historical memory alive, but to help inspire each new generation to foster their own spirit in hope for a better future, faith in God who leads us and instills within us life and blessings, and above all, love for our neighbors. Thank you for participating in this year's unique Greek Landing Day celebration, and please consider helping us continue to share these important stories by clicking the donation link below. And next year, we hope to welcome you in person.